Well, what I want to share with you today, I've entitled Ministry Credentials. I was saved in the 1960s, and for any of you that were in Christ back in those days, you may remember that there was a move of the Spirit whereby many hippies were getting saved, especially in the California area, and it was known as the Jesus people. And there was a pastor called Arthur Blessett who moved to Los Angeles to minister to these hippies. He rented a room in Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood, and he turned it into a church. It was right next door to all the nightclubs and so on, and he called this church his place. And he shared the gospel and ministered to the hippies that were coming to Christ and the drug addicts and the prostitutes at that time. And it was a wonderful move of God. And one of the things he did was to take a big wooden cross, about 10 feet high, and nailed it to the wall inside that little chapel. After a while, the Lord said to him to take the cross down and to take it across from one side of America to the other and just share the gospel. You can imagine dragging a big wooden cross across the continent of America would open a lot of doors for witnesses. What's this about? What are you doing? And so he was able to speak about the finished work of the cross and the love of God and so on. He led many people to Christ and prayed with lots of people and so on. After that, the Lord laid it upon his heart to take this cross to the whole world, to every nation in the world, which is, by the way, is something that he accomplished in, I believe it was 2008, went to every nation preaching Christ. He went to many dangerous places, many war-torn countries. In fact, he was right there in the middle of the Lebanese war. He witnessed to the Israeli army, and then he went across to the other side. And there's actually in his documentary a clip there of him praying with Yasser Arafat. And he ministered to people like Gaddafi and the Pope and many, many others. Quite a colourful character. Now, incidentally, of course, God told him to do that. He isn't telling us to do that. It was a one-off thing. And God used that in a very powerful way. At one time, he was walking across the continent of Africa. And he set out from Sierra Leone, and he had travelled for some 2,000 to 3,000 miles. And of course, he was very tired, very hot in the African sun, quite exhausted. But as he was getting to the end of this particular phase in his journey, he heard about this mission station that allowed missionaries to stay there for short-term rest, you know, to recuperate and so on. And he heard that they even had air-conditioned rooms. So he was thinking to himself, you know, I really would love to just rest up in one of these rooms for a couple of days, 2 or 3 days, just to get rejuvenated and then on my way again. Eventually, he found this place and knocked on the door, and there he is standing there with his 10-foot wooden cross over his shoulder. And he introduced himself. He said, "My name is Arthur Blessett, and I'm an evangelist. I've been going around the world sharing the love of God with people. And I heard that you've got a room for missionaries that you allow us to use, and an air-conditioned room. I'd love to use that for a couple of days, if that's okay." And the person looked at him and said, "Oh, sorry, our principle is that this is only for, you know, real missionaries that have been sent out by missionary organizations and that have got credentials to prove that they're authentic missionaries." And he said, but I don't have any paper with me or a card or anything like that, but I've been going all over the world preaching the gospel. I am a missionary of the Lord Jesus Christ and the gospel of Christ." And I said, "Sorry, it's our principle. We've got a certain procedure, and it doesn't fit in within, you know, the framework of what our guidelines are." And so he turned around, he thanked them, he turned around and walked away. And he said he was so hurt by that. He started crying, actually. And, you know, he thought, here I am, I'm a missionary. And because I don't have a piece of paper that says these are my credentials, I've not been accepted as a missionary. And he was walking down this road crying, and been walking for about half an hour, and this car pulled up alongside him, And a young couple jumped out and they said, "Hey, we've been hearing about you for weeks. Somebody told us you were coming this way, and we've been really looking forward to seeing you. And do you have a place to stay?" He said, "Well, no, I don't." And they said, "Well, we'd love you to stay with us. Would you stay with us?" He said, "I'd love to." And then they said, "Look, I've got to tell you, we're not Christians, we're atheists. Is that okay?" He said, "Of course it's okay. Of course it's okay." And so he went back to their place. They gave up their bedroom so that he could rest up for a few days and be refreshed. But you know, as he told that story, and I was watching the documentary in these times of lockdown, and I was watching the documentary, and as he shared about the way that the missionary station rejected him because he didn't have credentials, I felt his hurt. I felt that pain. But it's interesting that at the same time, I was reading through the second epistle of Paul to the Corinthians, and I've got to say that Paul went through a similar situation, in fact, probably a worse situation than Arthur Blessed did. You see, he was sent by God to the church, or to the city of Corinth. There was no church there. And he preached the gospel, and many came to Christ, and he laid the foundation for the church there. And he built upon that foundation. He was there for quite a few months. But as you probably know, the Corinthians at Corinth were quite carnal, and they really evaluated people on the basis of appearance. And there were these false apostles that made their way into the church, and they were very, very sort of demonstrative. They big-noted themselves, they were loud, they talked about their achievements. And in terms of appearance, Paul was just like a little dwarf in comparison with them, because by all accounts, Paul was not a very attractive man to look at. He was a short, balding man with a hooked nose and bandy legs, and, you know, not a sort of a charismatic figure either. And as for speaking, you might be surprised to know that he didn't have a great speaking gift. He had great content, of course. He had the revelation of the mystery of Christ, which he brought to the church. But in terms of his delivery, men like Apollos outshone him. And for the Corinthians, who were Greeks, they loved orators, people that could really speak well and demonstrative and use all this flowery language and descriptive language and so on. Paul was not that sort of person. And so they really, really criticized him and, you know, really spoke against him in that sense. And often he could see that these super apostles, so-called, were making their way into the church and having influence over what the Corinthians believed. And so Paul was getting concerned about this, and he was saying, "Why don't you listen to me? What sort of credentials have I got to present to you so that you'll really receive the fact that I've been sent to you by God?" He said, "If you're looking for letters of recommendation, you are my letters of recommendation. God sent me to you with the wonderful gospel of his love and grace, a gospel and a message which has been written like a letter upon your hearts." Let's look at what he said in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verses 1 to 3. He says, "Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? You are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Clearly, you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is, of the heart." Now, Paul is saying here, you don't need a letter of recommendation to commend us to you. You are that letter of commendation. Now, letters of commendation were very important in those times. If you can imagine, people could turn up at a church in any city and just simply say, "The church at Jerusalem have sent us to you. And that would obligate them in two ways at least. First of all, they would have to find accommodation for them and give them board and feed them and so on. But secondly, they would have to give them room in the pulpit to teach. And if they were false apostles, then they would be teaching wrong doctrine. So letters of commendation were very important, and the church used them, and Paul used them, we find. In fact, here is an example in Acts chapter 18, verse 27. We know that Apollos, who was a great teacher of the word, arrived on the scene fairly late in comparison with Paul and others. And we read this in Acts chapter 18, verse 27, that when he desired to cross to Achaia, which is where Corinth was, the brethren wrote exhorting the disciples to receive him. And when he arrived, he greatly helped those who had believed through grace. So there's an example of room being given to this stranger to the churches, that is Apollos, through a letter of commendation. But Paul said, you don't need a letter of commendation for me. I'm the one that came to you and founded the church. God used me to write his letter of love in your hearts. Now, Paul said then that Christians at Corinth were a living letter that validated his ministry. Now, I can understand, if we go back to Arthur Blessett for a little while, I can understand that mission station to some extent being reluctant to give board to a stranger with a 10-foot cross on his back saying, I'm a missionary, because they didn't know him. But this church knew Paul. They knew him very well. It was, you know, he even called himself their father. You've got many teachers, he said, but I'm your father in the faith. And so Paul appealed to them and presented this letter of commendation to the church to authenticate his ministry. He said the Holy Spirit is the writer. Paul himself was the pen, and the hearts of the Corinthian believers were the parchment upon which that letter was written. God wrote in their very hearts. They knew that Paul was from God. Now, Paul then goes on to contrast the old covenant and the new covenant in this way by using this very situation. He says that in the Old Testament, the law was written on tablets of stone. Now, we know that. God wrote the Ten Commandments himself with the finger of God on tablets of stone. It was very external. But the new covenant ministry is a ministry by the Spirit that is written upon hearts. In fact, the Old Testament prophets look forward to that time when such a ministry would take place, an internal work of God by the Spirit writing his letter of love, the gospel, upon our hearts. For example, Jeremiah chapter 31 and 33 says, but this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Ezekiel said a similar thing. He said, then I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within them, and take the stony heart out of their flesh and give them a heart of flesh. God would work on the inside, soften their hearts to make them receptive to his message of amazing grace. In chapter 36 of Ezekiel, verse 26, he says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. An internal work. You see that? I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Now, Paul says that's what's happened. We're living in those days. God has sent me to you to do such a work, to be an instrument in that. Now, he's quick to add this. Don't think, he says, that I'm big noted myself, that I'm saying that, you know, I'm special because God used me in that way. He goes on to ask the question, who is sufficient for these things? It's an amazing thing when you think about it, that God would use a human being to write his amazing grace upon the hearts of men and women that would change their lives forever and for eternity. So he asked the question, who's sufficient for that? No one can say it's because I'm special that God used me. So he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 4 to 6, and we have such trust through Christ towards God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant. See, that passage is so important for everyone that's in ministry. If anyone thinks that they're special and they start lifting themselves up, they need to be reminded that no one is sufficient of themselves. Our sufficiency is from God. But if others disqualify themselves and saying, I'm not good enough, God could never use me for such a thing, our sufficiency is of God. Our sufficiency is of God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant. Friends, we are ministers of the new covenant. When I say we, I actually mean all of us. Now, of course, I know that God uses special gifts, apostles and teachers and so on, to go forth and lay that foundation of the new covenant in the lives of individuals and churches. There is a special gift for that. And we know that God establishes his church on that. So, you know, we're not discounting those gifts or those local churches. We're not rewriting the New Testament. But what I'm saying is that when Paul says we, he means we. We are all ministers of the new covenant. This has always been God's plan for the church. And I find it exciting. Somebody said in our time before the word that when we come out of this coronavirus crisis, the way we do things, and especially the way we do church, is going to be different. It's like God is retraining us, taking us back to what really is church. And if there's a word that I could use, just one word that I could use to sum that up, it would be the word discipleship. Right from the beginning, Jesus never built a mega church. He could have. When you've got a crowd of 5,000 people who will follow you into a wilderness, you could build a big church. But Jesus ministered to them, then sent them away. What did he do? He poured his life into 12 disciples. And at the end of his ministry, he said, now go and make disciples who will make disciples who will make disciples. That's his way. And we find that in the beginning of the church, when the day of Pentecost was come, 3,000 souls were born again, poured into the church. There's a mega church. But what did they do? They discipled those ones. The Bible says that every day they came to the temple and sat at the feet of the disciples to be taught this new covenant, this wonderful truth of the love and the grace of God. And then we read a few chapters down the track that persecution came upon the church and they were all scattered, taking the word of God outside of Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria and to other parts. But who was it that went? It was not the apostles, strangely enough. It was the other people. They were the ones that had been trained, they had been discipled, and now they went forth and discipled others. And I believe this, that when we know the foundational truths, the core truths of the new covenant, such as our righteousness in Christ, a righteousness consciousness, the fact that we live now by grace, the fact that we have a new creation identity, and those kind of truths, when we just understand those and grasp those, we are equipped to pass them on to others. We are ministers of the new covenant. And when we minister the new covenant, lives are transformed. And that's what Paul was saying. Look what's happened to you because God sent me to you. You've become a living epistle. There's something about your life that you cannot deny. You feel it. You know it. You have received the revelation of it and it's changed your life. Others can look at you and see it. When they look at you, they are reading an epistle. An epistle that God has written in your hearts. Now, what is it that characterizes this epistle? What are the characteristics of the new covenant ministry? We'll just look at those because Paul speaks about that in this chapter. First of all, he says it's a ministry of life, a ministry of life. Chapter 2, Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6 says, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. See, Paul's contrasting between law and grace. The law is the letter. The letter kills. And the letter kills in this sense that it tells us what God's level of righteousness is. It inspires us to seek to live in that way. And we think we can, but we always fail. We always come short and end up condemned and killed. Paul said in his own experience, I was alive once without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived. The law stirred up sin, and I died. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and by it killed me. That was his own experience. I want to say that as a minister, when I first started my ministry, that's how I ministered. I ministered the law of God and I was killing people. It was a ministry of death. I would, say to people that this is what you must do. And if you don't do these things, then you can lose your salvation. You must read your Bible. You must pray. You must give. You must witness. You must come to church. You must, you must, you must. And if you don't do these things and Jesus comes back, he will not take you with him. That's how I ministered. I was killing people. They were not growing, they were dying until God opened my eyes and my whole ministry was changed. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 7, if the ministry of death written and engraved on stones, that's what it is, friends. It's a ministry of death. But the new covenant is a ministry of life. Grace, you see, is a ministry of the Spirit. As we said earlier, the Spirit comes to live inside us, to do the work for us, to bring the benefits of the finished work of Jesus to our hearts and lives. The Spirit gives life. I love this verse in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13. It is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Wow, that's powerful. See, we try to motivate people by guilt manipulation, by bribing them, by threatening them, by promising them and holding a bait before them and driving them. We do many things to try to motivate people. But God is the one who does the willing in the willing. It's God who works in you, both to will, to want to do what he wants us to do. It's a work of grace. It's a work of the Spirit, not only to will, but to do. He empowers us to do all that he wants us to do and to be all that he wants us to be. And there's no condemnation in that. It's a pure work of the Holy Spirit. That's the Spirit gives life. It brings the life of Jesus and imparts it to us. Jesus never came to give us a law. He came to give us a life. He said, I've come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly. You know, we see the contrast to that when we look at when God gave the law through Moses on Mount Sinai. While he was giving the law, they were at the foot of the mountain breaking the law. And you know what happened? Judgment came upon them because it's a ministry of death. And the Bible says that about 3,000 people were slain that day. 3,000 people were killed. It's a ministry of death. You know, in contrast, on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was outpoured, many people came to Christ. How many? The Bible says about 3,000. I don't think that's a coincidence. It's there to show us the stark contrast. When the law was given, about 3,000 people were killed. When the Spirit came and the new covenant was ushered in, about 3,000 people received the life of Jesus. It's a ministry of life. Christ lives in you to impart his life to you. But then secondly, we see that it's also a ministry of righteousness. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9, "For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory." You know, if there was one message I was allowed to preach, it would be the message and the doctrine of the great exchange that took place at the cross. The Bible says that all our sin, that's all our sin, past, present, and future, all our sin was laid upon him, and he bore its judgment. He made one sacrifice once for all and said, "It's finished. Sin has been dealt with at the cross." But in return, he imparted or imputed to us his righteousness. All that Jesus is been imputed to us. When God looks at us, he sees us as we are now, as a new creation, not as we were in Adam. He sees us as the righteousness of God in Christ, the one who fulfilled the law and imparted his righteousness to us. Now, look at this verse again. "If the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory." Can you see how these two things are opposite? The righteousness of God is the antithesis of condemnation. You cannot be righteous and come under condemnation. It's impossible. Because righteousness means this, that God has justified you. Justification means a declaration of righteousness. God is the one who made that declaration. Doesn't matter what other people say about you. Doesn't matter what the devil says about you. Doesn't matter what you say about yourself. That's not who you are. It's what God says about you. And he has justified you. He has declared you to be righteous. That's why there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ, to those who are in the new covenant. Now, the third aspect of this ministry of the new covenant is that it is a ministry of glory. Let's just go back to that last verse. It says, "If the ministry of condemnation," that's the law, "had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory." Now, there was a glory under the old covenant. There was definitely a glory. What was that glory? Well, it's the glory of the holiness of God. The law revealed the holiness of God. And when God gave the law on Mount Sinai, you saw and you heard, and you felt the glory of God. There was smoke, there was fire, there was lightning, there was thunder. The mountain was shaking, there were blasts of trumpet, and the voice of God that was so terrifying that they all wanted to run away. The majesty and the incredible holiness of God was made manifest before a sinful people, and they couldn't bear it. The glory was there, but it was a fading glory. And we see this, that when Moses went up before God, his face shone with that glory, but he put a veil over his face. Now, it seems that he put that veil over his face so that people would not look at the brilliance of his countenance. But when Paul comments on that, he gives another reason. He says he put that veil over his face so that they would not see the fading nature of that glory. You see, when you get inspired by the law and the holiness of God, we can be very passionate for God. We can be very enthusiastic about living for God and in his holiness. But because it's a marriage to the law, the flesh and the law, it's a fading glory. Whatever we determine and commit ourselves to do, it doesn't last. It's a fading glory. But the ministry of grace is an ever-increasing glory. Now look at this. Paul is sharing this with the Corinthians, the most carnal church in the New Testament, at least in the book of the New Testament that we know of. They were so carnal that there was not much of Christ you could see in some of them. And yet, it was the beginning. And Paul was saying, you watch this grow. It's growing. It's growing. It might be a little spark at the moment, but you are growing from glory to glory because Christ has predestined you to be conformed to his image. And he that began this good work in you, he will complete it. He is the author and the finisher of your faith. You will go from strength to strength and from glory to glory. It's a ministry of glory. And then fourthly, it's a ministry of boldness. When you know who you are in Christ, you have boldness, not arrogance or brashness or irreverence before God, but a boldness. Where does this boldness come from? It comes from knowing your position in Jesus. Let's look at what Paul says here in 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 12. He says, therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech. When we come to God in prayer, we don't come with cap in hand. We don't come begging and pleading, bowing and scraping. We come with confidence, with great boldness of speech, because Jesus has already told us that the Father loves us as he loves his own Son. And so we draw near with boldness and confidence. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 12, we read this, in whom? In Christ we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him. That's where our boldness comes from. It comes from our identity in Christ. Now, this really shows through in our prayer as we draw near to God. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 19 says, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus. God looks at the blood, and the blood bears witness to our righteousness. That's why we have boldness. Chapter 4 of Hebrews, verses 14 and 16. It says, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Boldness. In contrast, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13, Paul says, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face. Now, when people cover up, it's not because they're bold. It's the exact opposite. It's because they're shameful. They want to hide behind that veil. And you know, the great thing about the Christian life is that we don't have to hide. We can stand warts and all, not fearing that anything disqualifies us because of who we are in Christ. The one thing that Jesus spoke against and strongly condemned was hypocrisy, pretending to be what we're not, putting on a show, which is covering, putting on a veil. We don't need to do that in Christ. We can say, what you see is what you get. But as Paul went on to say, just two chapters later, he said, but from now on, we don't know anyone according to the flesh. We don't see any brother or sister or ourselves in the flesh, in Adam. We see ourselves as the new creation, as we are in Christ. So we don't need to cover. We don't need to pretend. We don't need to be hypocritical in that sense. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 14 and 15, until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament. That is, those that are under the old covenant, because the veil is taken away in Christ. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their hearts. But in Christ, the veil is taken away. We have an open face before God. We come before him with boldness and confidence. We use great speech in the sense that we can ask big because we have a loving Father who cares about us. The next thing that we find is quite closely associated to that, Paul says, is that it is a ministry, the new covenant is a ministry of freedom. Now, the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. That is such a contrast to legalism and the old covenant. Legalism is a ministry of shackles and chains. People are bound by rules and regulations. Many of us remember when we were under a legalistic mindset. People would always tell us, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't go there, you can't taste this, you can't look at that, you can't do this now. And it was all a list of rules. Now, that's gone. Bible says that we're free from the law. The law has been nailed to the cross. Does that mean we can do as we want? No. Now, this is where people go back to the law because they're afraid. If you say that to people, they'll just run wild. But look at what Paul says here. Now, the Lord is the Spirit. See, we need to trust the Holy Spirit in people's lives and in our lives. Don't, if you give them laws, it's because you don't trust the Holy Spirit to work in their lives. True liberty is not going back under sin, but being delivered from those very things that Jesus freed us from. But we need to realize that it's the Spirit that gives us such freedom and liberty. Trust the work of the Holy Spirit, for where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And then lastly, we see that it's a ministry which transforms lives. Paul says this in the last verse of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, but we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. See, this is God's way of change. Under the law and under legalism, we give people rules and say, do that, change. You've got to do this, you've got to do that. You've got to stop doing this, you've got to stop doing that. So there's this external marriage again to a law. But we are in the new covenant, and the new covenant works differently. And notice, first of all, it says here, we all with unveiled face. You know, under the old covenant, it was just Moses that went up into the mountain and his face shone. But under the new covenant, we are all being transformed, every one of us. God has no favorites. God has no superstars. We're all members of his body, and he's working in each and every one of us. We all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. That word transformed is a wonderful word because it means to be changed from the inside. Legalism attempts to change from the outside, but grace changes us from the inside. Remember, the Holy Spirit has come to live inside us. What does he do? He reveals Jesus to us. And as we behold, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, we are being changed into that image. How is that? Well, it's a wonderful thing because the Bible says that the Bible itself is a mirror. But how do you see that mirror? If you're under the law, you look in the mirror and you see yourself, and you have this whole list of things that you should be living up to, and you see that, no, I don't do that. I'm not living like this. I disqualify myself. You come under condemnation. But that's not how we read the mirror. We look into the mirror, beholding what? Not ourselves, but the glory of the Lord. Why is that? Because as he is, so are we. That's our new identity. That's who we are now. And as we behold the glory of the Lord in the Word of God, we are being changed more and more, transformed from the inside out into that glorious image. How? By the Spirit of the Lord who lives inside us. That's how New Covenant ministry works. You know, I was reading, just as I was studying this passage, about a condition called body dysmorphic disorder. And it's a very tragic disorder. When people look in the mirror who have this disorder, they see themselves, their face especially, as being grossly disfigured. They see it as being distorted in a horrible way. It's not, but it's just how they see it. It's a little bit like anorexia. You know, a thin person can look in the mirror and see themselves fat. They're not fat, they're thin. But that's how they see themselves. And in a similar way, a person with BDD sees themselves as being distorted and just disfigured in this horrendous way. And I was reading some of the ways that that works out in people's lives. For example, a young man might have gone all the way through college, done very well at college, and then he gets this disorder. He's not able to go on to pursue his career. He's locked away in his bedroom. And he's been in there for years, just comes out, gets his meals, go back in, because he cannot face people because he believes he looks horrendous. He doesn't, but that's how he sees himself. Or there may be a teacher that has that condition, and she's teaching her class, and of course the children are intently looking at her, and she thinks that they're looking at her face and seeing it in this disfigured way. And she just runs out of the classroom. She can't bear it anymore. And there's another young man, he's a salesman, and he's giving a speech to a group of sales reps, and they're also looking intently at him, and he thinks that they're looking at his ugliness, and he has to phone his mother maybe 10, 15 times a day to be reassured that he doesn't look like that. You know, some Christians suffer with a spiritual condition like that. They see themselves as the devil would have them see them, as those that are unworthy, as those that have failed God, those that have been disqualified by God, those that are going to be judged by God and condemned by Him. But that's not how God sees them. We need to behold in this mirror of the Word of God the glory of the Lord. We need to see our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our righteousness, who has qualified us for every good thing, who has baptized us into Himself, so that when we stand before God, which is all the time, we're always standing before God, as we stand before God, He sees us as we are in Christ. He loves us as His own dear, precious Son. That revelation is a ministry which will transform our lives. Now, Paul says to the Corinthians, when I came to you, the Holy Spirit began to do a work in your life through my ministry. And you know that these things are true about you. You know that you are experiencing life. You know that you are the righteousness of God in Christ. You know that you have a glory of the Lord about you, a boldness and the freedom and the liberty that the Spirit of God gives. You know that you're being transformed into the very image of God Himself. These are the credentials of ministry. It's quite interesting that Paul would say that, because many people say that the qualifications for apostolic ministry are miracles. Paul didn't say that. Paul said, these are my credentials. Look around. See how many lives have been changed. These authenticate my ministry. And friends, as we, as ministers of the righteousness of God, go out and share these truths as God leads us and enables us, we will see similar results. And I believe in these wonderful times, these incredible times of opportunity that we're living in, we're going to see this gospel of grace spreading more and more across the earth as we get a different vision of what church life should be. It's about discipleship, training others, sending them out, and reproducing. God makes disciples who make disciples who make disciples. I commend this word to you this morning. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you today for your amazing word, that though it was written thousands of years ago, it's a living word that applies so much to us today. And Father, I just pray that this word will take root in our hearts and bear precious fruit, that many will be disciples in the wonderful ministry of righteousness, who will go forth to make other disciples who become ministers in the new covenant. We ask it, Lord, in Jesus' name and for His glory. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.